So, is this a particularly special shirt, or is it just a shirt?
Signed by
everyone who's here tonight. We have a Liverpool FC shirt, rather bizarrely signed by everyone who's here today, including Nathan. He's a toffee, right, okay. That must have burned his hands there. I know half of you won't be interested probably, but half of you might be. Well, we'll start this one off at £5 for the signed Liverpool shirt. £30 for the signed Liverpool shirt. Okay, there you go. There's an Everton fan there who's absolutely stunned. So, any fans of £30? 35 anywhere in the room? That happens quick.
Yes.
£30. Anyone else? Going once. Think of how you'd look at the five sides for Jason Connery's autograph on your shirt as you're playing. 25 anywhere going once? Going twice. So the gem of the bar, £30. Thank you so much, sir. That's wonderful. You have done so well today. We are nearly at the end with our last panel. So I'll hand you once again to to Erica. Okay, I'll hand you to Erica, who's obviously got something to
just before I did the last panel, I just wanted to give a thank you. I want to say thank you for Charlie for emceeing today. Big thank you for Toby. Not only for spotting us on stage, but all the stuff that helps me with as well. So we're going to have an extra round of applause for Toby for me. My wonderful team, Mike with the videos. I have many Paul Griggs for his interview today. Paul Grant for all his work, driving, going around. Alex and Charlie, Dan, Sally with the photos. Give him a big roll for Sally Day. We wouldn't have a show without you, so give yourself a round of applause. But last but not least, I'd like to thank Paul Carmichael today, because we went behind at one point and I was really going, oh my god, and he's just pulled the whole event together. So can I just give a special round of applause to Paul together. And it's his first one. I do one next year. I mean, I don't know if you want one next year. Yeah! I don't know. Do you want one next year? Yeah! Okay, well, you're going to have to ask Alan and the family. Okay, we'll come back next year. Yeah! Okay, we've got to, right, can I just say, if you want anything in the auction, there's still a poster, which Alex has got, the DWM poster. Can you go and claim it now for us, please? Because I'll be drunk soon and I'll forget. Right, okay, I'm going to hand you over now to Toby. This is the last panel. Thank you for being a brilliant audience. Thank you for supporting the event. And I'll see you all again next year.
Someone's left their wallet lying around, which I'm not sure is terrible, guys. But we have one more interviewee. And to give that some context, let's first play the clip package.
I wanna be a producer with a hit show on Broadway. I wanna be a producer, lunch at Sardi's every day. Thank you.
ladies and gentlemen, the producer of some bona fide Doctor Who classics and the consistently most lauded era of the show's history, it's Philip Hitchcock, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for joining us today.
My pleasure.
And how do you vote? Because I've worked with you obviously on the DVDs, and that's a slightly different atmosphere to this because we consider the conversations over the videos. How do you? I think quite a reserved, not a showy person. How do you react to these sorts of do's?
I'm beginning to like them. This is great. I love the atmosphere.
Yeah.
I love the atmosphere. Yeah. It's very different.
Yeah.
I've begun to do a few more small conventions and meetings. I've only done the one in America. But this has got a different feel, and it's great. Yeah, it's nice to be here. Never been to this part of the world before, so it's great.
Well, that's the fantastic thing about Doctor Who, isn't it? It leads you to all sorts of different places. I have to say, I read with a heavy heart about 20 years ago a one-page article in Doctor Who, it was called DWB, I think, and it was billed as the last ever Philip Hinchcliffe interview. And you said at the end, yeah, I think I've said all I need to say about Doctor Who, so I won't be doing any more of these. So what's changed?
Did I say that?
Yeah.
Well, I suppose at that time I wanted to get up. Well, I don't think that the people asking me to do interviews, it was very, I'm not being condescending, but it was very sort of early days and amateurish. And I think there was a point at which they'd have interviewed me every day of every week, if I'd let them, yeah. So I think that was what lay behind it, and obviously I was busy doing other things with it.
I mean, those clips that we've just seen are all from stories that are all very highly regarded. Your era, I think, is consistently the most highly regarded of the classic series run. So what is it, do you think, that if you're analysing your own work that you brought to the show, or that you wanted to bring to the show, which was your aim, that has made those stories all seem to go down in the lexicon of the classics of Doctor Who? What was it that you had, or that you wanted to do, that you felt was different from what you inherited, or what came afterwards?
Well, there's about five questions there.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't analyse your own work as you're doing it, and you don't even analyse it, you know, a year or 5 years later. You only comes to an, I don't think I have analysed it really, but I've been asked, you know, why do they seem to, you know, the test of time, they've survived these shows, and I mean, in a way, I get the answer from the viewers, really, and the fans. I mean, Tom, I think, was a sort of very charismatic actor, and he just brought something very special and lovable to the role. I like to think that within the confines of the money and the time we had to make our stories, that maybe we made the stories a bit more sort of plausible and believable. Maybe more adult might be the wrong word, but somehow to sort of raise the standard of the show in every way. So, for example, I was thinking, what am I going to say when I come up here? And I was thinking, well, what have I not said before? And I think, I've never done this, but I bet if I counted, this is one of the things that illustrates this, if I counted every cliffhanger of every episode that I produced, a lot of those cliffhangers would have been invented and insisted upon by me at the early story stage. As well as later, the Doctor facing execution, you know, the Mask of Mandragora, and also other details which were not cliffhangers. But for example, when we did the android story, you're never going to believe who's an android and who isn't an android unless you see it. And so I sort of invented and insisted. I went to special effects and said, can you do a face for Sarah Jane and make it fall off? And can we do this? And they said, yes. And so they built this face with all the wiring behind. And so that moment when, you know, the android rolls over and the face splits off, that is the clincher.
Yeah.
You know? So in a way, that was my approach, in a way, was to up the ante of suspense, really get strong cliffhangers, if not double cliffhangers, and where you could sort of nail the effects well, you know, do that. That wasn't the whole of my approach, but I think that sort of made people come back, you know, and want to watch it, you know, like the old-fashioned serials and the movies. Really.
And obviously you famously had the Mary Whitehouse criticising violence. When you look at, obviously, television today, it's a whole different ballpark in stuff that's considered acceptable for kids. So where do you, now, looking back, where do you stand as a viewer, as much as anything, on levels of violence in television and, you know, what is acceptable as entertainment and what isn't? And have you changed over the years from when you were actually presiding over something that obviously went out for, with a children audience in mind?
Yeah, it's a very good question. Of course, the BBC always said that Doctor Who was not a children's programme. It wasn't made by the children's department. I mean, that's not a defence for, you know, what you put in it. But I think it was always seen as a family show rather than a children's show. And so I think when somebody like Mary Whitehouse sort of approached it, I think she just assumed it was a children's show and probably in her own mind had an idea of what the age of the children, you know, might be. And it is difficult because, you know, if there are 6-7-year-olds watching, but in a way you have, I mean, I felt that, I still do, you know, it's the parents know their own children, they know what their children can watch. But on the other hand, if you're putting out a show which you know most of the nation's children will be watching, then you have to have a sense of responsibility, which I felt we did have. And on the other hand, I was young, I don't ever think that I was, in all honesty, I don't think that I was ever guilty of sort of sensationalism for its own sake. I think I was always clear as to how far we could go, but I did push right up to the boundary. But I think another distinction to be made is between, and I think Mary Whitehouse used to confuse this as well, it's sort of what is the horror element and what is violence? And I think she was often talking about violence, and really she meant this was a bit too scary. And the two things are separate. And I think you can go quite a long way with scariness, as long as you keep the scariness in a sort of another world. It's when, I mean, other producers have broken this rule, but I never broke it. I mean, even Barry Letts, who was a sort of the best, most proper sort of producer, really, he ran into trouble because of the Bob Holmes story with the, you know, the terror of New York, the dolls and all that sort, because they were coming into the domestic home.
Well, there's a policeman.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, yeah. And so I thought, no, you can't do that. So we never ever did that. We never ever brought horror into the domestic setting of the real child watching in the home. And I think that was the sort of the biggest safeguard. So all our horror moments or I don't think it was huge amount of violence, but sort of action sequences. But, you know, the famous one for Mary Whitehouse was the sort of the drought. What she didn't like was that it was a cliffhanger. You know, the doctor was under the water. I mean, but every kid knows the hero is going to survive. But yes, it might be distressing for little ones. But I think we cut it back to the point where it was okay. So yeah, we did. I mean, where I got to the where I had to edit sometimes, and I've said this before, was when I had underestimated the power of the performance the actor would be giving, and so I met that problem in the first story, Ark in Space, where, you know, Kenton Moore was sort of gradually turning into a sort of green thing, And it was a bit too strong linked, really. So I took the decision to cut that scene. So yeah, sometimes it was difficult. You know.
I bet it was more difficult for Kenton Moore. He's probably sat at home saying, "I'm brilliant in this bit that's coming up now."
he was over egging it. So it's difficult, but if you asked me, no, today I would stand by all my decisions. I think the climate was changing, and although Mary Whitehouse in a way had that there was room for someone to be standing up for the listeners and viewers against the monolith of the BBC. I think she just was a bit behind the times, really.
Well, and then it's very interesting that you mentioned the monolith of the BBC, because you've talked before, obviously, about the day-to-day production of Doctor Who and your attitudes towards it and things like that. But, of course, you were working within the BBC, which is this vast corporation of whom you are an employee and of whom Doctor Who is a representation to the general public. So did you ever have to were the BBC politics, how did you have to sell the show to your bosses, and what was your relationship with the machine that was the BBC?
Well, I had a very good relationship. I knew the way it was set up, your immediate relationship was your head of department, who was, for me, Bill Slater and then Graham McDonald, but really Bill Slater during Doctor Who. And that was the relationship. And I was never, put under any pressure at all. It worked very well. If you thought you had a problem, you had a thing called you referred upwards. And I think there were a couple of occasions when I referred up to Bill Slater and said, do you mind having a look at this? This is my view of this final cut. What's your view of it? I don't think anybody stepped in and said, you can't do that.
And what did you learn from Doctor Who that you took on to other productions, as you said? Because obviously, too often we talk to people who've done Doctor Who just about Doctor Who, but you did so much afterwards. What did Doctor Who stand you in good stead to do later on, would you say?
I think I learned a lot about storytelling. I obviously knew a fair bit, but I learned a lot about how adventure storytelling, genre, film writing, script writing. So that stood me in good stead. And I learned quite a lot about actors. I didn't know about actors. That was my weak spot, probably was for a long time. So I learned a lot about actors, and I also learned a lot about the production process, really. It was my first job. So there was a lot to learn, and also not the politics of the BBC, but just how to get the best out of the BBC.
Well, and you mentioned both storytelling and the actors there. So you had, as your script editor, I think generally regarded as the finest scriptwriter Doctor Who ever had, was Robert Holmes. So tell us about your relationship with Robert Holmes.
I was very fortunate to have Bob, he was just an excellent writer, a very imaginative writer, and a very good script editor. And we just had a very good personal relationship. We didn't fraternise outside work, but we had a very good working relationship, and lots of fun, lots of laughter, a lot of pressure, but we both handled the pressure. I think I was quite a hard taskmaster on Bob, but he rose to the occasion brilliantly and did some massive rewriting, a lot of page one rewrites. But I think, I suppose in a way I wanted everything to be a success, so I was, I had a very high standards, didn't want to let things go through, and if that meant rewriting four scripts, then that's what we would do. He was just terrific, and saved a lot of shows, and also, as I've said this before, but his imaginative bent and his sort of penchant really was very much more the horror sort of stuff, and sort of sardonic humour, which he brought to it. And I think I brought sort of a bit more imaginative sort of sci-fi thinking, and other sort of deeper ideas that sort of got into the stories as well. Whereas he was the story maker and the storyteller.
Well, it's interesting because we think of your era as largely being gothic horror, but of course there are other sci-fi tales. But those that there are, like the Robots of Death and Face of Evil, they come from a literary tradition of sci-fi.
They do,
they?
Yeah. They're right, and I think that's probably me. Yeah. Well, Robots. I've read iRobot and I thought, I'd love to do a robot story. How can we not do iRobot but do a robot story? But it was Bob who said, well, let's do it. In fact, we probably had to do it one set, because that's pretty much what the constraints. But he turned that brilliantly on its head and said, right, let's do this like a closed, like a country house mystery. story, like an Agatha Christie. And so that was his insight into it.
But then, as so often with Yuri, everything seems to come together, because yes, it's merging of Agatha Christie and Isaac Asimov, which is a very fertile thing. But then you get a director and a designer who come in and make it look very interesting. It's a great cast as well. But it seems that every department fires on all cylinders. So is that you? I mean, did you pay close attention to all of those areas?
I did, actually. And you asked me, you know, what did I bring to the program? I don't want to sort of sing my own praises, but I think something I did differently, because I got a sort of visual kind of imagination anyway, is that I really paid attention to production design and all the other bits and pieces that, you know, the visual effects, and I really struck up a good rapport and used to sort of check out whether we could do these things before we finalised a writer to go away and write the script. So there was a sort of organicness, and so then, because of that, somehow the designers and were sort of had an investment in the basic original creative idea, and I would tell them. And it wasn't as if they just turned up at work one day and, oh, I'm doing that next week, oh, and they read the script the first time. I kind of told them and involved them as best I could. And I think that meant that they raised their game and they did more for it, you know. So it was getting the team players to really use their imagination to bring something more to it, and being open to what they brought, you know.
So indeed, and so that does beg the question, and I think we've established that, you know, this is as good an era as Doctor Who ever had. And working with lots of very, very talented people. Why did nobody during the Android Invasion go, surely Guy Crayford's going to take his eye patch off when he washes his face? Didn't somebody?
There's a lot of silly moments like that. Yeah, I think we did say that many times.
Yes, one of the great unanswered questions. Did Guy Crayford never wash his face? But okay, behind the scenes, in front of the camera, you've got Tom Baker. Who, as so many would say, was born to play the Doctor. And you were there right from the beginning, before he became, you know, the legend that he now is, I guess. So how was it seeing Tom develop? Did he change over the course of your tenure? Because he certainly had changed by the time he gave up the role of the Doctor, and he freely admits that.
I don't think he really changed in the 3 years. It was 74 to 77, not 75.
I didn't do the video.
No, but it's everywhere. You know, someone somewhere else said it's 75. It's 74 to 77. So it was nearly three seasons. And I don't think that, Tom got a bit more, he got more confident very quickly. I ironed out a few ticks very early on. I think he comes from Liverpool.
He does.
Anyway, he was a sort of sniveler.
Like that.
It was a tick he didn't know he was doing, so we stopped that straight away. But there are a few other things. But he quickly got confident, and his natural humour, his natural sort of charisma as a person came through. And he, you know, as soon as he got the feedback from the audience, he gained more in confidence. And so it was just a joy to work with him, really. And again, I used to sort of let him in on the process, just in broad terms. This is what I'm planning to do. I'm thinking of doing this, taking you into this sort of story. This, you know, something to do with your background. We might, you know, and when, you know, Liz went, he said, do we really need it? And that's a companion. I can do it on my own. And I said, well, you know, you can't do it forever on your own, but we'll do one without you. So there was a bit of to and fro, but he was never running the show. You know, I was running the show, but it was a great relationship, and I think we both joined together. We both sort of plunged in together. We were both enthusiastic. We wanted to do something new, and he just loved this. I mean, he became, you know, it's like being a pop star. You know, if you became Doctor Who, and then became popular instantly like that, it was like becoming a pop star overnight. So it changed his life. But I don't really think there was any change in him except he got better, really. Yeah.
And it's interesting because part of being a producer is making the show, is managing its public image and things like that. But it's very interesting that through the whole of your tenure, and indeed through the whole of the Tom Baker era, the most popular and famous of all of the classic doctors, he never had a Radio Times cover. So, were you ever conscious that you had to, that was part of, or did you, it just seems to me that you were just quietly getting on with making a good programme and hoping that that would speak for itself?
Well, it was part of luck, because it was a very, getting the Radio Times cover was a very political item. I think we nearly got it a few times, and I had plenty of Radio Times covers later in my career for other shows I did. It's complete pot luck. And in those days, it was the controller of BBC One who would choose the Radio Times cover in cahoots with the Radio Times editor and David Driver, who was the, I think, the art editor. And I had a good relationship with David Driver, so it wasn't as if we were, you know, it's just the cookie didn't quite crumble for us on certain occasions, probably when we would have normally have had a cover. No, it wasn't a question of not trying to get it, but it just never happened. Yeah. But we got some very good, I mean, I remember, I've still got the original, what they call a pull, Frank Bellamy for the Loch Ness Monster. He did a wonderful sort of drawing, and I've got, not the original that he did, but the first print that they do, David Driver gave it to me. I've still got that frame. And I think that was the result of not getting the front cover. I think we were due to get the front cover, but our week broadcast was changed. And so I think the consolation prize was this huge colour spread inside the Radio Times. And that was David Driver sort of saying, sorry, can't give you the cover, but, you know, because Brian Howell wants something else. But, you know, so we got a huge spread inside.
Excellent.
So, it was just political, really.
Well, it's interesting because mentioning Zygons, they've just come back in the show. They were in the 50th anniversary. So do you watch the show now, and what do you make of it?
I do now and again. Remind me about the 50th one.
That was the one with John Hurt and David Tennant.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's right. And then
the Zygons came back.
Did we see Peter Capaldi at the very end? Is that the one? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
No, that's right. Yeah, we did. So
what do you make of the show that you see now? Do you still?
I think the best thing for that anniversary was Mark Gatiss's play film. I thought that was so good. I had no idea that they could make a story of the origins of Doctor Who with Verity and everybody, Brian Cox. I mean, they were all wonderful.
There's a marvellous cast, right down to the smallest
part. David, what's the cast?
David Bradley.
David Bradley was just sensational. I didn't really know Bill Harner, but David Maloney, who I knew very well, he was directing a lot of shows for me, you probably know. And he was a floor manager, I think, with Bill Harner.
Yeah.
And he used to tell wonderful stories of how Hartnell used to get a little bit on his high horse every so often. He was covering up and he couldn't always remember the lines and all the rest of it. And David was so funny, you know. If Hartnell threw a wobble, he'd sort of say, stop everybody in the studio, stop, bring Mr. Hartnell a chair, please, bring him. And he'd sort of go this sort of, he knew how to handle him, you know. He was a wonderful character, David. But I knew a bit. I mean, I was still at school when that first. I can remember seeing that first episode. It was my last term at school, funny enough. And I thought, well, this is better than rubbish. And not watching that again. And 10 years later, I was producing it. Strange, isn't it?
And you've never escaped. You never. But let's throw it open to the floor because we haven't got too long. So just right at the back there. So, for those of you know, Philip wrote some of the Target novelisations, but also including one not from your era, a William Hartnell story, The Keys of Marinus.
Yeah, I think that was a mistake. I'd done two of my stories, which were easy, and then they asked me to do another one. I foolishly said yes, and didn't know anything about it. And I looked at the episodes and did my best, but I couldn't get any real sort of pizzazz into it, you know. Sorry about that.
No, I love your books. Why did you not do any more in the
interest? Well, they only paid you £300 a book.
Right.
Mind you, that was about 3,000 in those days, but even so, it wasn't good.
So it was the money and having to make the Keys of Mariners interested.
Yeah, I couldn't do any more. I could have done all my own stories, I would have done them.
Okay.
But Terence Dix had already done them, I think. Oh, he does one a night.
Yeah, yes, he does. Yes, sir.
A lot of the Doctor actors have trouble getting work afterwards. Is there a problem with typecasting or something?
Oh, you mean the ones who play the Doctor?
And the companions.
The companions. Yes, have they? Yes, I suppose they have, really. Yes, if you think of Liz Sladen, yeah. Maybe not so much Mary Tan, but yes, probably. It is difficult, I think, for people to reinvent themselves when they're so identified. So yeah, it can be a bit of a trap for them. Yeah. I don't know the answer.
Lady, yeah?
Really showing Philip Hitchcock presents a big finish. What was that like, and will
you
be doing anything
at all
with them?
For those at the back, so Philip Hitchcliffe presents the season for Big Finish. Will there be more? And tell us about them.
Yeah, they're going to be... you mean the box set?
Yeah,
that's right. Yes, I've done another story and I've nearly finished the second one. So that will be a new box set, yeah. Yeah, well, the idea of that, for those of you who haven't seen them, or heard them, rather, is that Big Finish, you do the audio Doctor Who's, they asked me whether I could do, I sort of did, well, they said, have you got any stories you didn't use? 40, 50 years after. So I said, no, not really. But I said, well, you know, a few things. I think they thought that Bob Holmes and I, in the 3 weeks that we were doing the next series, and then we didn't, that somehow we conjured up all these stories that were lying in a drawer somewhere. But I did say, there are ideas I hadn't used. And yes, I would be interested in sort of exploring that. And so the idea was to recreate stories that would have fitted into my era. And so Tom and Louise do it as if it's still, you know, in their era. And so we've done this first box set, and now we're doing the second one.
Now, yes,
gentlemen
at the bar.
Just again, the question for a friend who could be here today. If you ever going to reclass Doctor in your era, in your time, who would have been your choice if Tom Baker had been recast in your
Bond? So if Tom Baker had left and you had to cast somebody else as Doctor, because you never got to cast a Doctor, of course. So who would?
Oh, thank God. That's very difficult.
Who would you have cast as Doctor Who?
Oh, I don't know. I've never really thought about this one. So, I can't give you a name off the top of my head, but I think it would have been a sort of quirky character actor rather than a leading man, if that helps. And probably if I go, I'll probably think of a few on the way home, but I never had to really think about it.
Well, you've given us a lot to think about and a lot to digest. It's been absolutely fantastic. It's flown by again. Time is typically our enemy, so all I can do now is ask you to show your appreciation, and what a pleasure it's been. But it's Hitchcliff.
So he's only able to do one item per person for signing, so that's just going to do that. Got a signed Big Finish script here, Doctor Who Phantom of the Deep by Jonathan Morris, and it's signed by Tom Baker, Mary Tam, John Leeson, Alice Krieger, and the other members of the cast who I've never heard of, and it's signed as a full Big Finish script, and that's the last item in the auction. So again, we'll start off £10 everyone, £10 everyone, yep. Oh. Again, you got beaten. I don't know how you do this. 10, let's see, 15. 15, okay. 30. Anyone else? £30 gentleman there. Oh, 35 over there. Oh, 10 PayPal as well. 50 at the back. £50. 55 here.
I was a good, ooh, I like that. 55 over here, to the right, and see an advance of 55. Again, that happened quick, you're all very generous. About £55?
60.
60. 65. She wants it. 65. Going once. Going twice. Sold! Oh, quick, please. That's great. Last you got something. There you go. £65. Brilliant. Okay.
Charlie, if I'd done that, I'd go for about £7.50.
Oh, be quiet. Right, we have the raffle here. So get your raffle tickets out. Everyone lined up over there, get your raffle ticket out. You won't have to give up your place in the queue, don't worry. Okay, Toby, you can pick the first one for the glamorous assistant.
This is for two tickets for the DWAS 80s convention.
Two tickets for the DWAS 80s convention.
Oh, it's a round one. It's 400.
400. Are they all the same colour? Yes.
Pink, 400. Pink
400.
Pink.
Pink. Oh, 400. Pink.
Ah, you can float them on.
Legitimate winner, there we go.
Okay. What's the next prize, Erica? Two tickets to Pandorica. It's a Phantom Films event.
Okay.
Okay, on you go, you may as well. Just have a seat and, you know. Can someone get Toby a drink while he's doing this?
No, there we go. Right. Right, it's that one. Oh, it's, if you folded yours very well, it's that one. It's pink again, and it's 338. 338.
Yeah, oh, that's me. There you go. 338. So we've got a winner there. Yay! Yeah, round of applause.
Right. Okay.
And what prize that would be?
You get the other tickets.
Right. Okay. So right. Okay. So we've got a selection of items, Doctor Who items. We'll put the chairs here, and you can just come up.